Thank you very much, Speaker. And yes, I am excited to rise today as the member for Berwick. Obviously, I've been the member for Gembrook for 12 years and thoroughly love serving the electorate, which started off as 2,058 square kilometres, went down to 400 square kilometres when I took over the smaller part of Gembrook, and now we've gone to 90 square kilometres. So the first person that thinks this is wonderful is my wife, who, when I get home from events that go till 10 o'clock at night, I'm only 15 minutes from home, not an hour and a half at the top end of the electorate. But to the electorate that I was in Gembrook, I wish everyone the best. I thank them for the support. I thank them for working with me over the period of time. And I note that they now have, obviously, Emma Vaughan, the member for Pakenham, and I congratulate Emma on her role there. She did forget in her inaugural speech that some former members are very, very kind and may or may not have left a bottle of Chandon in the office for her to drink. If anyone over there hadn't heard of that, that means she didn't share it with you and didn't really like you. I'm sorry. But we get into the now. I'm actually really excited to represent Berwick. Why? I played footy in Berwick. I've worked in Berwick. I was a paper boy in Berwick walking up and down the main street at 12 years old. I am born and bred in Berwick. I simply love my community. There is nothing about Berwick that is bad. We have an amazing school where I went to. Maybe a little bit bad. They did ask me to leave before the end of year 10. But other than that, it was a pretty good school. Some of the teachers there are still there, and I want to thank them for their support. Some of the teachers along the way would be Peter Slate, who's still at the school, who was actually someone, because I did have a choice in life to go down a difficult path or the one that I ended up choosing going into work. And it's people like Peter Slate that give you the guidance along the way. Stuart Daly, who I look forward to having an award named after him in my local electorate for primary schools, who was my teacher in grade 6, who, while some of his jokes would probably be best left behind, he is a person that supported not just myself, but other students as well from Harkaway Primary, where I attended primary school. And no, I didn't get asked to leave Harkaway Primary School. I saved that for high school only. But I had the pleasure of working in some of the car yards in Berwick. Yes, I was a used car salesman at some stage. I know a lot of my constituents would love to hear that. We know that's out there. And that's exactly right. And I've also gone out and I've worked in houses and real estate through our area. And I'll have to say, other than this role, I've worked in the Victoria Police, but other than this role, working in real estate in Berwick was one of the easiest things I had to do, because it was not hard to sell to people and families why you would want to live in our community. One of the challenges we've got is growth. Clyde North, we've seen the growth down there. The expectation for my seat by the next election, instead of being that sort of 50,000 which we're all targeting as our voter numbers under the redistributed figures, will probably up about 60,000. By the 2030 election, I estimate that'll be up around about 75,000. That's a lot of people in one electorate. The city of Casey will go up to around about 400, aiming at 500,000 by 2040. We need to plan for that growth. Now, I could stand here today, Speaker, as we know, and just absolutely hammer the government on what they haven't done. But what I want to talk about is the future of the area that I love. We need to start to work together on what we are going to do and start to put in place a plan for 2040, 2050, 2060 out to 2100. What are we going to be doing for water? What are we going to be doing for food? What are we going to be doing for public transport? How are we going to move people around in our roads without causing the disruption that's currently there right now? These are plans that, in all due respect to people within this chamber, we don't have all the answers. But what we do is we have access to people who do understand this. Now, whilst developers sometimes can be seen as a negative word, developers also understand exactly what is needed to keep people moving. Yes, they're driven by money. I don't mind that. But if they're out there and they can come up with some genuinely good plans that we can put into a 2050 portfolio, so any government can come in and have a look at how our infrastructure should be assembled going into the future, where kids are going to go to school, some of the changes that will happen with ageing populations. There'll be areas where we've got schools now that in the future we won't need that number of schools. You've obviously got areas out in our areas, through Pakenham, through Berwick, through Casey, through Cadinia, where you need more schools at the moment because the number of young families moving into those areas. These are things that I think we continue to do a band-aid fix on rather than having a blueprint of what we need going forward. The impact of that is it makes it more and more difficult through areas like Clyde North, as an example, just to travel around. To get onto Clyde Road at the moment is an absolute nightmare. some of the intersections down there that have been under construction now for 4 and 5 years where they've been closed. This is an impact on business. It's an impact on getting kids to and from school. It's an impact on the public transport sector through there because they have to travel slower. There's no positives out of the impact of what's happening with some of the infrastructure down there and the delays in getting it done. This goes to also in the private sector, and I call on the private sector, Clyde North has very limited place for families to go shopping. We have an Aldi. We've got a couple of other smaller shops through in Clyde North. Over in Solandra Rise, there's a Coles. But on the other side of the main areas of Clyde North, in Clyde Vale, etc., the shopping centres aren't going to be up until 2025. So again, we're seeing people travel outside of those areas. They have to travel further each time to do their shopping, just day-to-day things, which is impacting on their lives. These are the things that we need to be making sure are in the plans and in the plans early. And when you're talking about an area like Clyde North, without fail, the number one thing that comes through my office is the phone reception. Mobile phone reception, you would barely date it at 1993 with the infrastructure down there. And I'll take it up, but it's not a federal issue. The issue is planning. The Telstra have agreed and got money for it. The government have agreed and put money on for it. And I'll even say the Labor government in Victoria have agreed and put money for it. The issue is every time it's gone to council, it gets knocked back because the state planning laws allows that. So the new infrastructure that should have been up in Clyde at the new ovals, which are currently getting built down in Clyde, was knocked back by KC Council under state provisions. So, can we fix it? Yes, we can. Let's actually say, without putting the politics in it, why wouldn't we then say, like on any PSP for any development in an area, we have to currently put where sewerage is, where Telstra is, where the drains are, where power goes. We have to put every single thing on that plan now to ensure that parks are delivered, schools are delivered, but we don't put where phone towers are going to be. Now, we all know phone towers, they're not a beautiful palm tree like you would see up in Queensland. They are an ugly-looking thing that you don't want next to your house. And people will say, I want the tower, but not in my backyard. So the two things to fix that is, number one, you can put them on shopping centres. That is actually allowed at the moment. Challenging Clyde North, as I said before, we don't have the shopping centres till 2025. You can't put the towers up till the shopping centres are built. That's the smaller ones. But the larger ones, if we had it on the plans to start with, exactly the same as families live next door to a railway station and choose to buy next to a railway station, or they live next door to a freeway and they choose to buy next to a freeway, if you had the plan in place for those towers going to in place, people could choose. And that may be a bit cheaper property, it may be cheaper block of land, but they know what's coming next to them and they know it's going to get put up in those areas. It's a simple fix. It could be something that you used all across those growth corridors, and it would save the number one issue that we've got coming through the office, which is around that, in that area. We're very keen to see some of the developments down in our area, and I've met up with the Brentwood Park Playgroup, who I know are very keen to see some developments. Whilst we'd committed in relation to what would happen down at the specific Brentwood Playgroup, we wanted to expand the playground. We've gone and had a look and it actually needs further funding. We could actually upgrade the entire park there. Again, working with council, it's in an area that needs it. We committed fundings to Princes Highway, Coniston Avenue intersection upgrade at Wilson Botanical Gardens. The gardens, again, they're in my beautiful Berwick, so they're beautiful gardens. We had an issue there during COVID because it became everybody's backyard. When that happened, the car parking wasn't accessible for a lot of people. They started parking along the highway, which is now no standing, which I do support. Now they're parking across the road. When you walk across the road, I saw it just again the other day, and it nearly makes me sick when you see a family trying to run across with a pram on a road where Mick Morland was killed walking across. If you're not taking care, we're going to see a tragic accident there. The council now has admitted that. They need to see the funding for that, and I'll be keeping to support to see the money coming in for there. Grices Road Reserve, I note that the Labor has committed $1.2 million. We'd like to see some extra money in there, so we've got the upgrades to not just the facilities, but also the grounds as well. We've gone through the infrastructure upgrade for mobile. We also want to see the Clyde Rail Link. Clyde needs a train station. It needs a station extension from Cranbourne to Cranbourne East down to Clyde. It was committed by Labor in 1999. It was committed by Labor in 2002. It was committed by Labor in 2006. It was committed by Labor in 2010. It wasn't committed by Labor from then on, and they still don't have it. By the time we eventually put a railway station in, every house will have 3.5 cars as an average, and they're not going to change their habits just because the Labor Party decided to put something in so late there. We want to see that infrastructure as soon as possible. We acknowledge the fact that they've done the duplication down to Cranbourne. That's a positive. We're starting to see some of the positives out of that. We've seen the grade separations. I knew Abbotts Road, etc., from being a police officer in Dandenong, but we do need to see the extension going down to the growth corridors down where we are. Edwin Flack Reserves need some upgrading, and we need to have a master plan about what we're going to do with sports. More and more young people are playing so many different sports, and we're seeing the Berwick Football Club, Beaconsfield Football Club, they have not got places for the kids to play footy. They've run out of ovals. Now, part of this is council. Council actually, they're planning, they've got overflow grounds, and I have to ask them the question, what is an overflow ground? And they go, it's for when the facilities are full that you can use it, so we've got an extra place for them to play. Okay, we've got seven teams missing out on playing any sport at the moment because they won't use the overflow ground because it's used for overflow. And I'm trying to work out what the definition is. I can't get that. The other side of this is, due to changes with the lighting in most of these, we've got 9 facilities through Cadinia where lights have been taken down, reducing the amount of hours that kids can be out playing sports, training, getting ready for this pre-season that's coming up. That includes cricket, football, all of those sports down there, and we need to see an investment, a big investment in basketball. Basketball is so rapidly growing through our community. We know it's an expensive sport, but again, through education department, through the government, through the councils, there's nothing stopping us building greater and better facilities that can get used during the day from schools and then used during the night from community. There's some great examples out there where it have happened. We know this has happened at the Officer Secondary College. This is the sort of thing that I think I'd be pushing for so that we can have at Berwick College as well. They've already got a basketball program. As I said, other than they asked me to leave, it's an amazing school. They could see that ability for something like this, which I may have engaged in when I was in school, because not every person is going to remain in there for academics. Just finally, Speaker, we all know that we don't get into this place without the support of many. And that takes, obviously, I spoke about my wife before, but it takes your family, it takes your friends. We all know, I think every person's room had to ring up a few friends and just go, come on, mate, just 2 more hours on a polling booth for me. Every minute helps. And we all go through those same pressures, and it is changing. It's not as comfortable on the polling booths anymore. It is changing on the polling booths, the behaviours on there. And I will say, predominantly out in the Berwick electorate, it wasn't the major parties that were creating conflict that was on our booths in there. It wasn't coming from people within this chamber or people from the party rooms, from the parties of either in here, but there was an increased conflict. Now, credit to the marijuana party, I've forgotten what they're called, the marijuana party. He was very calm the whole way through, but everybody else in there seemed to be very up and about. But he did bring in some great munchies for the days as well. But I'll give him credit, it was fantastic. But I want to thank some people out in my area, Karen Chipperfield, Shane Miller, Elizabeth Donaldson, Adelaide Donaldson, Trent Simpson, Olga Kelwaite, Jess Vidic, and Liam Petrino. They not only dedicated time to supporting me the whole way through, they gave up some work. Some of them gave up 2 weeks of work or took 2 weeks of leave to come and support me, and I want to thank them for that. My chair, Phil McCready, who has been my chair since day one of getting into politics, I approached him when I first got pre-selected and asked him to be the chair of my campaign. He asked me why I didn't vote for you, and I said, that's exactly why, because you were honest enough to tell me you didn't vote for me, and you gave me a true feedback on what I did in my pre-selection, which I thoroughly supported. So to him and Lorraine, to my staff in my office who worked tirelessly, Susanna, Shemaine, Sam and Ashley, who all do an amazing job, who continue, and currently Nick, who's over there at the moment, but he wasn't there before the election, he was busy in Bayswater. But for the ones that are there, I want to thank them very much. We all know that we don't do this job ourselves, and to support and work within our community takes that little community and little team to make sure that we can get everything answered. And I will finish by saying to all of those electors in Berwick, to the people who ran as well, to Malik Sevier, who ran as the Labor candidate, can I thank you all? The election period was a fantastic election and example. If anyone ever wants an example of how an election should be, Berwick overall was it. We had no issues, we had no conflict, we had no other dramas going on. Myself and Malik worked very well together when we needed to be and sorted out issues. But to the Berwick electorate, thank you so much for the honour. My wife is very, very pleased. I'll finish off a little joke. She used to be the flog with the First Lady of Jembrook, and now she's the flob as the First Lady of Berwick.